Hello, I'm Dr. John Iskander. Welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Dr. Anthony Komaroff, professor of medicine at Harvard University. Thank you very much for joining us today.
My pleasure, John.
Dr. Komaroff, at today's session, the focus was on a disease often commonly still referred to as chronic fatigue syndrome. You've written very articulately about what CFS is and what it isn't. Can you just start with your perspective on that?
Sure. Well, what it isn't is the common periods of fatigue that nearly every human being experiences. It is a very unusual, prolonged, and debilitating state of fatigue with a group of other symptoms. I think the cardinal parts of the illness are what's called post-exertional malaise, where any kind of effort, physical but also mental, makes all of the symptoms worse following that effort, typically about 12 to 48 hours afterwards. A second big part of the illness is cognitive problems. A third part is unrefreshing sleep. People who basically never awaken feeling rested, even if, as far as they know, they had a good night's sleep and slept for many hours. And the last manifestation is orthostatic intolerance, people whose symptoms are made worse by standing up and maintaining an erect posture, and whose symptoms improve, if not being fully abolished, by lying flat or putting their legs up. Those are the cardinal manifestations.
So clearly what you just described differs significantly from, as you say, as ordinary fatigue or fatigability. What do we know about how common CFS is in the population?
It depends. There have been different case definitions of CFS, and depending on which ones you use, you get somewhat different answers. I think the best answer is in a range of between 4 and 8 per 1,000 adults. But it's higher in women adults, and it appears to be somewhat lower in children who get this illness as well.
So not an exceedingly rare condition.
No.
Have we, through research, developed some hypotheses about what some of the triggers or risk factors for this disease might be?
We know that many, but not all, patients with the illness, in my experience, the majority, say, I was perfectly fine until one day, and I came down with this flu or whatever. They describe an infectious-like syndrome with aching muscles, fever, swollen glands, gut symptoms, neurologic symptoms. And they say that acute illness got somewhat better, but I feel I have never recovered from that. And now it's months and years later. So that it suggests that at least for some people, many people, there may be an infectious trigger. Whether any infectious agent, but no infectious agent has been convincingly tied to this illness. And I think it remains very uncertain whether an infectious trigger also goes on to perpetuate the symptoms. That I think we don't have much evidence for so far.
Yeah, so we heard today, actually, I think that about 3/4 of cases,
yes,
may be preceded by some type of infection. We also heard from the National Institutes of Health about a research study that they're planning looking specifically at individuals with post-infectious CFS.
Right.
What might we hope to learn from that kind of research?
Well, I think the biological research that's been done so far, and an enormous amount has been done in the last 30 years or so that I've been involved with this illness. There is now over 9,000 published articles, and they point to abnormalities of the central nervous system, autonomic nervous system, immune system, and energy metabolism. And so I expect that the NIH studies will find some of the same things. Hopefully, they will find a few additional things, including if they're lucky and we're lucky, a true pathologic gold standard biomarker for the illness, because we lack that now. And if you don't have that, it's awfully hard to say to anyone, you have this illness definitively, and it's very hard to test the validity of any case definition without a gold standard biological marker against which to test that definition.
Yes, very, very interesting. So again, we have very strong evidence for underlying biological processes. We're still in the process of trying to translate those into biomarkers or diagnostic tests.
Right, by which I mean a biological abnormality that has such a low false negative rate and low false positive rate that it constitutes a good diagnostic test. That we don't have. Plenty of biomarkers that clearly and statistically significantly distinguish cases from controls, healthy controls, but also control subjects with other fatiguing illnesses. But none of those is so sensitive and so specific that it is an adequate diagnostic test.
Okay, certainly. Dr. Komaroff, you referred to the fact that there have been many, many thousands of these studies done on chronic fatigue syndrome. Much of your presentation today focused on a recent report from the Institute of Medicine, which tried to synthesize a lot of that. Can you summarize for our audience what were really some of the key take-home findings from that very comprehensive review?
Yes, it was a Herculean task. This panel of, I think, about 25 scientists, different disciplines, reviewed each of over 9,000 published articles, and they concluded that there was lots of evidence using different technologies of central nervous system problems, autonomic nervous system problems, and that includes cognitive deficits that are objectively measurable, white matter problems, evidence of neuroinflammation using ligands with PET tracers that light up in inflamed areas of the brain. Immune system abnormalities, the two most robust of which in their review were natural killer cell dysfunction that correlated with illness severity, and elevated levels of various cytokines in the periphery, typically in the blood, that suggest a state of chronic immune activation.
They also, I believe, proposed a new case definition, which you alluded to earlier. They also proposed a new name for this condition. Could you tell us a little bit about why a new name might be needed?
Sure. I think the name that this illness has been called by most often, chronic fatigue syndrome, was really coined by a group organized by CDC back in the late 1980s. And the focus of the group was on creating a case definition. I was part of that group. None of us was even thinking about the name. And when the name chronic fatigue syndrome was suggested, everyone said, well, sure, why not? I think that was a big mistake, because the name, in my opinion and the opinion of a lot of people, is it both trivializes and stigmatizes the illness. It makes it seem unimportant, maybe not even real. So people have looked for a better name, one that doesn't do that. This committee proposed systemic exertion intolerance disease, because exertional intolerance is a core feature of the illness. Whether that new name will take with the professional community and the patient community, I think we still don't know.
So let's come back to the patient. We've really tried to make that the focus of this session. What are the prospects for patients in terms of recovery? We know we do not have any definitive cure, but what are the prospects for treatment and recovery for patients?
For recovery, there aren't a lot of systematic long-term studies to address that question. my synthesis of those that do exist and my own personal experience caring for hundreds of people over 30 years is that most adult patients, in my experiences with adults, have a terrible first year and then have some improvement thereafter. Whether it's true improvement or an improved ability to cope with the illness, hard to tell. About 5 to 10% of patients return to what they feel is a fully normal state, only 5 to 10%. And a substantial fraction of those will have a relapse. So, although I wish it were different, I think the majority of patients will, at least if our experience over 30 years is a guide, are not going to fully recover absent a really important discovery and new treatment.
So we heard today that for pediatric patients, perhaps their long-term prognosis may be a bit better. But
yes.
What are some of the things on the horizon that that offer hope, that offer grounds for optimism for patients with this disease and for clinicians caring for these patients?
I think the greatest grounds for hope is that when this disease was first resurrected, I think the disease actually has been discussed in the medical literature for centuries, but the renewed interest beginning in the mid-1980s, at that time, no one knew anything about it, the biology of it, and no one in the world was working on it. Now, laboratories all over the world are working actively to try to figure the disease out and have discovered, as we've discussed, a lot of clear biological abnormalities that are bound to allow us someday, and I hope it's soon, to find definitive treatments, interventions that make people a lot better. Just the fact that so many distinguished scientists are now actively spending a lot of time working on this problem is, I think, should be grounds for hope for everybody.
And we'd certainly count you as one of those distinguished scientists.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Komaroff. Please join us next time for Beyond the Data.